I got to Vietnam, where you have an in-country orientation for two or three days down at just north of Saigon, and then they ship you out to your unit, and I got shipped up north up in the mountains. And so my first night there in my company, I was a gunship pilot, and so we had a gunship company. There's 26 pilots in a gunship company, and so the first night they're going to greet the new guy. And so part of the greeting was, what's your nickname? And I said, well, I don't have a nickname. And they said, well, what are we going to call this new guy? And I'm a second lieutenant, you know, and I'm a gung-ho gunship helicopter pilot. And there were suggestions made, not too many. No, thanks. I was the only Texan in this 26 pilots, the only Texan. And as I recall, this guy from New Hampshire said, he's a Texas Aggie. The worst thing you could call a Texas Aggie is Bebo. And so all these other guys from Montana and, you know, Louisiana, anywhere else, they had no clue, no idea whatsoever. But this guy, for some reason, he knew that Texas Aggies and Bebo, that's, you know, gasoline and alcohol, it doesn't mix. And so I said, no, you're not calling me Bebo. I said, y'all just line up, I'll whip every single one of you right now, but you're not going to call me Bebo. Well, the more I complained, you know how that works, the more you complain. So I will tell you this, that I made captain while I was there, and I have this wonderful plaque at home. Says to Captain Jim Bebo Singleton for your meritorious duty. And it's somewhere in the bottom of a box in the attic. Can't even display it, but whatever. It's nice to be here today. I appreciate it very much, the opportunity to come to talk to you about interesting Brazos County architecture. I think in your announcement you said unique. Well, interesting, unique. I guess some interesting architecture is unique and some unique architecture is interesting. So whatever you want to call it. I think the goal today, too, is not to give you a history lesson or a lecture about the history of architecture in this area, although I'll mention some names and some dates and some old buildings and some new buildings. But what I really want to do is to just make you a little bit more aware of the beautiful, the wonderful, yes, the very interesting architecture that we have in the Brazos County, Brazos Valley area. First of all, Jim Singleton Architects is in a 1947 warehouse building off of Cabot Street, in between Cabot and Texas, and Bryan. The warehouse was a 1947 Bryan Coca-Cola syrup warehouse building. Mr. Steffen was going to build the bottling plant there on that property, and he started with this building and then changed his mind and built the bottling plant downtown on 22nd Street, I believe it is, in downtown Bryan. But that's where we are. We've left the building intact, the exterior, the inside, we've dressed it up and it's a fun place to work, but we even left the garage doors operable so that on those few wonderful days that we have, we can open up the doors and feel like that we're practicing architecture outside. What I want to do is talk about when you're driving around town and you're looking out your car window, what do you see? Are you just looking, or what do you see? Here we drive by and we see the old Parker building. It's been several things, from a laundromat to offices to an incubator for offices, the development company and so forth, over on Parker Street. But as you drive by and you're looking, what do you see? You go about 50 feet, that's all. Wow. You go about 50 feet and what do you see? Temple Frieda in the reflection of the window across the street. Temple Frieda, this wonderful little building, a Greek Revival building that was done in 1912. The Jewish community that we had here at the time, and they worked out a deal to open up this congregational church here. What's interesting, I think, about this is that Frieda was the wife's first name, and very unusual to have a church named apparently after a woman like it was. But here again, when you're driving along looking, make sure you see the beautiful architecture around. Just across the tracks the other direction is St. Andrew's Episcopal Church. I know you're going to think this is maybe a little bit selfish, but this is where I go to church, where Stephanie and I go to church. And I'd like to make one correction on the MD. Stephanie and I were both Chamber of Commerce Citizens of the Year. We appreciate that very much. But the St. Andrew's Church, what I find interesting about this being built in 1914, we have a big celebration coming up in a couple of years. This site was selected because it was the highest point in Bryan, the tallest point in Bryan. And then they were so excited that they got this lot. And then they ordered this set of plans to build the new church. And the plans were too big for the lot. Prior planning, it's, you know, got to get the cart before the horse or horse before the cart, whatever. So what'd they do? They cut 9 feet off of the nave there and then just shortened it a bit so they could cram it on the lot. And when they did that, boy, from the front door, it was just very, very, very steep down to the floor. I see Judge McDonald back here. Get Judge to tell you how tough it is, or how tough it was, to carry the caskets down those stairs after the funerals. Dangerous. So about 10 years ago, as you see here, we did a complete remodeling of the front entry, made it ADA accessible, where now we have wonderful, comfortable steps going in and out. And anyone in a wheelchair can now go in the front door, where for about 80, 90 years you couldn't do that. There are a lot of buildings in Bryan, College Station, around that we could talk about. The Ice House, the Howell Building, the Risco Building, First Bank and Trust, 1930, the Municipal Building in 1930, which is now the Children's Museum, the Bryan Federal Building, LaSalle Hotel, all of those in downtown Bryan, they were very, very interesting, wonderful old buildings. Like I said, I don't want to get into that kind of thing. I just want you to be aware when you travel around. But Carnegie, how fortunate we were to have a Carnegie Library here. Giesick, I believe is the way you pronounce his name. He was head of architecture at A&M for many years and designed several buildings on the A&M campus, designed the building. It's was open from about 1903 to 1969, then it was closed, but then through some fundraising and grants and so forth, it was reopened in 1999, still a wonderful building. I put it in here because I think it's interesting that out of all the Carnegie libraries that were built, there's not that many that are still open and running, and yet there's one in Bryan, Texas. This is one of my most favorite buildings as I drive around and look and see the architecture. The old Masonic Lodge building, built in 1910, and this is the way it looked in 1910. You know, it's just not been abused at all. It's been well maintained, but it has very simple detailing, very simple characteristics. It's just a nice building. And so nobody did anything to it because you didn't have to. Good detail is good detail forever. The length of the building, the life of the building. You know, we drive around now and we look and we see these strip centers going up and we see the Best Buy and the Office Depot and Barnes and Noble and all these tilt wall buildings where they actually pour the slab on the ground horizontal and then they tilt the wall up and form the wall of the building. And we say, wow, isn't that great? That's fantastic. Vilas Motor Works, originally Burnath, Plymouth, 1947, the first tilt wall building built in Bryan, Texas. So it's not new, folks. Stuff's been around a long time. And I'll emphasize that a little bit more as we go through some of the other slides. Like I said, I just want to try to make you aware of things. I think it's interesting, too, that First Baptist Church of Bryan, 1866, and then they built another building in 1884, 1905, 1927, and other buildings and remodeling. And yet this property that was the First Baptist Church is now judges' offices, commissioner's court. It's good to see that these good old buildings have other lives, and that we can use and reuse these buildings that are built well, designed well for a long time for various other purposes, as is Bryan Coca-Cola Bottling Company. Built in 1947, a wonderful building. It was built by Mr. Steffen, of course. He always wanted to do things right, and that building could have been a bunker. It was so well built, and so even after Ms. Sale sold the company in 1998, it was such a good building, it remained to be something else, and now it's the Longhorn Steakhouse. So it has future life, and I think it's interesting there and good to see these well-built, good buildings being used forever and ever. Architect Studios, another architecture company, and Bryan, Charlie, and even Mike, good friends, good architects, wonderful people. I just love the way they took the old Tremont Dry Goods store downtown Bryan and converted it into their offices. I like that attitude, and they've done an excellent job. It's a wonderful building. Likewise, the International Harvester old building. They've kept this somewhat of an art modern design back in the 50s, but they kept that. They didn't destroy that. They kept that appearance when they turned it into this decorative center building. It's very, very nice. I think that it speaks well of the style of the building, what it was, how it functioned, and where they could use it and reuse it for their own use. This is Dr. Searcy's old building, now used by Patterson Architects. And I was told that McKee and Camrath were the architects, original architects for the building. I did some work with Carl Camrath many years ago. Carl used to work for Frank Lloyd Wright. Oh, now look at the building. Now what do you see? Now you see the Frank Lloyd Wright details, right? You see the big swooping overhang, the prairie style of architecture that Carl got from Frank Lloyd, passed it on, and so, yeah, we've got some influence here, even in town with the Frank Lloyd Wright. Got another example of that we'll talk about in a minute. Henry Mayfield was an architect back in the 40s, 50s. One of the five architects who actually started the American Institute of Architects Brazos chapter, which the architects in Bryan College Station are members of now, 1952. An excellent architect. And I wanted to show this building because I think it's interesting. And it has wonderful lines, wonderful design. And you see the low profile roof, the steel columns, the stonework on the base that gives it this pedestal effect, pedestal look, some real strength about it. It's just well, well done. The old steel casement windows, yes, they're not efficient anymore. I don't know how that you can maintain the design, the character, the beauty of the building, and I hope that the present owner does. It needs a little dressing up, and I hope that it maintains it. But as I drive around and look and see the architecture, interesting architecture, this is one that I drive by almost every day going to work, and I just really like it and wanted to show it to you. Vrooman, the all-face chapel. He was a professor at A&M. This was a design competition. The all-face chapel, built in 1957, and it too had the Frank Lloyd Wright influence. You can see with the somewhat prairie style look of things. When I came to A&M, yes, played football. We had Henderson Hall. We lived in the football dorm, which is right behind the all-face chapel. And there were so many times that we just cut through that yard to go to class, to walk on down the architecture building. And so I became very fond of the building, even when I was a freshman at A&M a long time ago. It's a wonderful building. It's still a beautiful place today. When you go inside, you get the feeling you're in a special place. It's good design. Good design is good design. It lasts forever, and this building certainly has. I want to show you a few houses, not get into a whole lot of details, because there's so many of them in town that we could talk about. But this particular house, the old Wilkerson home, 1926, Dr. Wilkerson. Dr. Wilkerson, Dr. Searcy started a clinic in 1931. Maybe some of y'all can relate back to all of that. But this house had solid rock walls. Solid rock walls, the first of its kind like that in Bryan. But what I think is of particular interest and interesting here is that you see this front rectangular area, this big opening going into the front porch with the stone walls. And you have to know that that has to be a really good beam to come across there to span that opening and yet support all that stone up above, knowing that this is a solid stone, solid rock wall construction. And yet that form, that shape, is used even today. And 80 years later, about, with a brand new home in Miramont, you see those same rectangular openings within a masonry wall. Here again, emphasize that good detail is good detail. Carries on. And then even in a smaller detail, you have the projections through the walls to emphasize whatever openings you want. In this case, at the end of a gable or a truncated gable with the arch up there. Very nice. Here's a stone wall of a fairly new home. This home was built in the late 80s, but you see a stone wall, solid stone wall with all the gables, and yet, you can go back, and what do you see? A solid stone wall with all the gables, and 60, 70 years later, similar kind of details, even though it's old coming into the new. Here's a couple of examples of some details that I like. We'll do three or four slides here, and then I'll show you another one. But you see the soldier course of stone across the top of the windows, and then you see the front door framed with the stone in contrast to the brick. Nice detail, just wanted to emphasize that front entry. That was this building was built in the 20s. And then here we come along one in the 50s, and they're still using that sort of detail. So as you drive along, you can see all the old buildings, but you can compare one to the next and see that some things haven't changed. Or you get to another older home, and there's some brick detail around the front entry to the front porch, and even a larger archway over the front porch. Then all of a sudden, you see a new home being built that just loves all of it, and they just put everything in there. They put the stonework around the entry, they put everything, all the details that you see and all the other old houses, even in the new houses, they come along and they just love it all, I guess. Or maybe they couldn't decide which one, so let's use them all. We've talked a little bit about the prairie-style homes that Frank Lloyd Wright really started doing after the turn of the century. And this low profile look of the homes with the low sloping roof, the larger overhangs. So many houses typically use a 2-foot overhang. I don't know exactly why, but then all of a sudden you'll find some of them out here that have a larger overhang, and you can realize about when that was built. And they look nice and they still function well. And it does shade the house, and it's efficient and its shading of the walls, and the heat transfer through the walls is minimized, so your energy is less, energy use is less. All of that's good. And yet, here's a brand new home in Miramont. And look at what they've done. The low slope roofs, large overhangs. And again, I know I sound like a broken record, but you know, good detail is good detail. And use these good ideas that have been in existence for years and years and years to have a nice home. The brick wall at Miramont, I've heard that that brick wall had 2.3 million bricks. Miramont's a special place. It's a beautiful place. You know, the country club is, again, when I watched a presentation being made, that's the fourth largest country club in the state of Texas.
It is.
And it's in Bryan. The fourth largest country club in the state of Texas, right there in Bryan. And it's beautiful. It's a chateau-looking building. Gorgeous, wonderful. But the brick wall is exquisite. And I can't help but see that brick wall every time I drive by, and I look at all the wonderful brick detailing there, the openness of the bricks, the soldier cores, the rowlocks, the running bonds, and then capped off with the cast stone there. It's just a beautiful brick wall. This is one of the interior brick walls. The exterior brick walls are solid without the openings. And so as you're driving along, you know, be sure and look out and see that wall. And then you realize, boy, this must be an important place. This must really, really be an important place to put that much emphasis on there. To go back to a couple of houses, and we have a lot of beautiful, beautiful old houses. This is the McMichael Wilson home. It's 1903. What's nice about this is it's a beautiful Queen Anne style home. Queen Anne in every detail of the word. But look, you see the turret there on the upper left? Any of you see that? When you look at the wall, see the turret. In the back of this beautiful Miramont Country Club, this French chateau-looking monument out there, there's a Queen Anne turret. And so when you look at the wall, you see that turret behind, and you wonder, wow, isn't that something? That the architects sort of co-mingled some details there, and yet still beautiful, still lovely, wonderful. So again, it's a matter of just looking and seeing and enjoying, appreciating what all we have to look at. Hey, how about this for some architecture? I love it. This will get a little personal, but Stephanie and I wanted to show you this. But Producers Co-op, yeah, this is probably more engineering. It does fascinate me, though, to look up at all those pipes and tubes and wonder, how do they know where all those seeds and grain and feed and everything are going all over the place there? It's quite something. But in architecture, we have a little phrase that we say, form follows function. And as you look at the Producers Co-op buildings out there, or if you look at some of the cotton gins, the old cotton gins that we have in the neighborhood, in the county, this Porter gin right here, you'll quickly see and wonder, I have this big roof there, and then this one piece that just bumps up like that. Or how about this big metal overhang over on this side? And these cotton gins all take a shape of their own. And you wonder, how does the form follow the function? What's the function in there that they're really using all this metal for to shape these buildings? A lot of them are very, very interesting and beautiful buildings. Likewise, you get out to Feathercrest Farm out on Highway 21, you see the silos. Well, you never know what influences an architect, you know, but can a silo influence an architect? Just a big old silo. See the top of this silo here, both of these silos? See the top? That's all it is. That's all it is. And I happen to know this for sure because this is our stables. And it was when we were driving by Feathercrest Farm and we were trying to figure out how do we put a round top over the walker, the electric horse walker. And what a perfect fit. So all we did was buy the top off of a grain bin silo and use it at the stables. It worked well. And then just as we love this agrarian economy, agrarian area that we live in, with all the metal roofs and metal walls, we built our house out of metal roofs and metal walls. That's simple. We love all the cotton gins. Made sense to us. Why not just make a house that looks like a cotton gin? So we have metal walls and metal roofs, and then you see the long sloping metal roof coming out over the top. Pretty nice. Tell you this, pretty economical. You get down to the Allen Farm and looking around, you know, we talk about in architecture, we have to build to building codes, ADA standards, Americans with Disabilities Act. It's a law, it's not a code. Health, safety, and welfare is very, very important to us. And so oftentimes in buildings, not oftentimes, but every time in a building, you're designing to these building codes. And then we hear this word green. You know, oh boy, all the architects are, you know, designing with green, green, green. What does this green mean? Well, I'd just like to give you just one little sentence about green. I think green is designing with common sense. When you live at Allentown and you know there's not a fire truck anywhere around, why not just put a ladder from the second story bedroom window down to the ground? So I'm driving along, looking out. Stephanie and I were on a drive one afternoon, and I said, look at that. Isn't that smart? To put a ladder, obviously, to a bedroom window so that if there is a fire, you can get out of there alive. So it's interesting to me. It's fun, really, to see people that have the initiative and the thought to put this kind of detailing into their houses when they know that that's the right thing to do. This is what it looked like when I came to A&M. Unfortunately, you know, this is what it looks like today. What a beautiful, beautiful building. Built from 1936 to 1940. Truly an Art Deco building in every sense of the word. Had a lot of fun there. Got to see a lot of old movies and so forth. Well, they were new then. But I hope that someday that we see this again. I wish that there was some way that we could be more strong in our abilities to retain the great architecture, the symbolic architecture that we have in our community. And this is one of them. I think it's a beautiful old building. Maybe someday, somehow, someone will make it look like this again. Half a dozen guys in a couple of days, we could rip all that wood off of there. I'm sure we could, you know. Might take a six-pack or two, but we'd get it done. I wanted to show you this. This is a project that I did because as you're driving around and you're seeing the architecture in the community, I'd like for you to think and wonder maybe, well, how did the architect come up with that? You know, what made the architect think about this, or the builder, whoever designed the building? Why are some buildings shaped like they are? This is the A, the logo of the Brazos Valley African American Museum. Now, you kind of have to turn your head to the right, and you can see the A lying down. It's this way, you'll see why in a minute. But it's a symbolic A, three elephant tusk, the red, green, and black symbolic colors of Africa. And this was their logo. their program. They wanted three different galleries. It was a small building, but they wanted three different galleries. They wanted a genealogy room and a classroom and this and that. So, you know, what inspires an architect to do whatever? But I took the logo, started playing around, and just morphed it into a building, basically. That's what I did. I played around and played around and just turned the logo, the A, into a building until we finally had the final building. And I'll show you the floor plan that you can see. There's the A with the A and the cross with the three symbolic elephant tusks. And so as you drive around, you're looking and you're seeing, think about what maybe inspired someone to do whatever they did with the architecture. And then maybe you'll think back and see that, well, just a little idea turns into a nice building. It was a very fun project working with them. It was a wonderful organization. Interesting architecture. Well, when I go home and I'm taking University West toward the airport, you go underneath the tracks. Remember when we used to go over those tracks? You see the vet school on your right, and you see the first building of the vet school there on your right. This was 1940. This is kind of like a time-lapse photography as you drive down the road and look to your right. This building was built in the 40s. This year, they've changed the windows. And you can see that the old casement windows, these were all operable, just like I was talking about the Mayfield apartment house over there. Yes, they're not efficient, they're not good, and things have to happen to make them better. And so certainly, the tinted glass, I'm sure this is a low-E insulated glass as well, probably improved the energy use of this building 100%, maybe more. And it gave it a fresh look. So, but this was still built in the 40s. The next building was built in 1967, and you can see the change of the style. All these windows, all the operable windows, but then we have air conditioning and we don't need all those windows. And so we build these big brick boxes. Well, you go a little farther, I mean, the next building, 1978, boy, the style then, you know, it's kind of like, all you ladies, excuse me, but you know, fashion. It just changes 10, 15 years, and then things come back and just rotates round and round. Well, what was in fashion, what was in style then was this low-profile building with the deep, dark windows. I think the IBM building built just a little bit before that really, really got a lot of architects working on that because everybody was copying the IBM buildings. And I think that's where some of this came. But this one you see is 1978. Then along comes 1991. What I find interesting about this, and I'm not going to go all the way back through all the slides, but this goes all the way back to me to the 1926 Wilkerson House, where we had that rectangle opening there at the front porch. They've recessed these windows. You can see the windowsill there. They have the sloping stone, and then they put the glass way to the back. There must be 18 inches deep, and creates that deep, dark, rectangular shadow there for the window. And again, it's like the 1926 Wilkerson house or the brand new house out at Miramont. You see these details, they keep coming and coming. But notice this, when they just completed last year the building addition to the back, they did away with those windows. And they used the tinted glass windows, and they have the little awnings that stick out and cover the windows. They kept the same brick, they kept the same stone detail. So it's interesting, again, to me to see how they complement the architecture because it's nice, and they sort of put in the present day detail construction methods and so forth that we use today. Then here, the next building, wow, what a change. Here's the 2009 TIPS building, Texas A&M Institute for Preclinical Studies. And I'd like to insert here, you've heard of the biomedical corridor. You've heard that expression. Well, you get to these buildings and you go from the track. Let me back up here and show you. Okay, right after the track, you have this building on the right, remodeled, then the next building, then the next building, then this building, then the TIPS building. This clinic, preclinical studies, this is for large animals. This is the only one of its kind. There are things going on out at Texas A&M, and I know I'm a prejudiced, proud Aggie, but there are things that are going on out there in the research that are just incredible. No matter where you went to school, you have to appreciate what's going on in the research park and all the research at A&M is doing, this in particular, one of them. But the architecture is very nice. And it's, as I'll show you some others in a few minutes, it's sort of what's in vogue now in style and design of architecture. You go around the corner, this building isn't, it's the next building, but it's not right by the TIPS building. You have to go down the driveway and then turn around behind those trees to see this, and I would recommend any of you to do it. This is a lovely building. This is the National Center for Therapeutic Manufacturing. Again, an incredible building, incredible research. The students at A&M go to class, they study, then they go down the hall and they help with the research. And then they go out and actually manufacture in the big manufacturing warehouse. Boy, all in one. And it's a beautiful building, and you can see the different style of architecture getting a little more modern, a little more contemporary possibly, but mostly just a little more modern in today's world. Go on around out to the Health Science Center. Wow, what a facility this is. And from the National Center for Therapeutics Manufacturing on around 47, that distance in there, all of that they expect, it's been master planned now to be the biomedical corridor. I think for the next many years, 20, 30, 40 years, you're going to see just some incredible development going on in that area. But here, what's so nice is they have, again, research, huge amount of research going on. But then right next to the research building, they've built the office clinical building where doctors actually can have their clinics as the brain and spine, whatever the institute is it called. They're up on the fourth floor here. Well, they see all their patients, and then what do? They go across the parking lot and do the research. It's tremendous what's going on in this biomedical corridor business. The MSC, I wanted to show you this because we see what's going on out there with the MSC now with this incredible $130 million renovation. This was a nice building back in 1950. Beautiful building, again with the prairie style, pretty dominant in its design, although it was pretty modern as well. And there's that Wilkerson, that old 1926 Wilkerson hole right there in the front of it. Just love it. But then today, this is a rendering of what the MSC is going to look like next year. They're planning April of 2013. They're going to be tight, but I guess they'll make it. Going to have a dedication at muster, I believe, so they're going to have to make it. But you can see it's going to be a beautiful building, wonderful space for the students, and an awful lot of fun. So what's going on in today's world of architecture? You see a lot more modern detailing of the Mitchell Engineering Building at A&M, beautiful building. This is the Sheriff's Office, a new building built about 3 or 4 years ago in Bryan. Very, very nice building. So you can see we're getting more and more modern. But again, you'll see a lot of the same details being used just in a more modern way. And the police building in Bryan, I think, is so nice. Brings me to what I think is a very interesting building, the Queen Theater. Yes, this is going to be a little bit selfish, and yes, I'm going to hit on you a little bit. But, you know, this happened when Ben Hardiman and Tommy McDonald were talking one evening and said, golly, you know, they're not taking care of the Queen Theater. It's falling apart. Boy, somehow we gotta save the Queen. We got to figure out how to buy the Queen, save the Queen. And then Tommy talked to me, and then the next thing I know is Nancy and Ben and Caroline and Tommy and Stephanie and Jim are standing out on the sidewalk in front of the Queen Theater taking $20 donations for a t-shirt. And we sold a lot of, we passed out after your $20 donation, passed out a lot of t-shirts. We were able to have fundraisers, and collectively, with a lot of support from an awful lot of people that finally got on the bandwagon with us, we're able to purchase the Queen, and since then we've done some tremendous renovation work. Here we are, that's me and Ben and Tom, we're down there, and we took all the marquee off, and we're getting it done. A few weeks ago, last month, we had the relighting of the marquee and the crown and the letters Queen. We've restuccoed the whole front. We have a new glass entryway, new ticket booth. So we have the front facade done. We're now working on replacing the roof. And as I've put the brochures on your tables there to show you what the plans for the Queen are going to be in the future. It's going to be a multi-use facility. We're going to be able to have conferences. We have the Fiber downtown Bryan. LaSalle Hotel is very excited because now they will really be able to advertise for conferencing because they can use the Queen for audio-video conferencing all over the world. We're going to have receptions. This time we will put a small stage. We're going to have different levels for dining instead of just the one sloping floor that used to be there, so that we can have wedding receptions, weddings, dinner movies, dinner theaters, whatever we need to have. And you can study the brochure. There's an address there in a way that you could send in a pledge if your heart so desired. We would appreciate any of the help that we could get. Here's the lighting, exterior lighting. And I will show you there on the marquee, it says, Happy Anniversary, Stephanie, from Jim. That's interesting. 15 years last month, and I'm a lucky, lucky man. But you can rent the marquee. As this past week, or maybe it's still up there, you can go down there. It says, Happy Birthday, Caroline McDonald, from Tom, Don, Scott, and Hunter. So you can rent the marquee. We're waiting for the first one, Susie, Will You Marry Me, Zach. You know, we don't have that one yet, but we're waiting and hoping that we have that one very soon. So I want to take you full circle now and go all the way back to where we started. There's a lot of interesting architecture in Bryan, Brazos Valley, Brazos County, College Station, Texas A&M, everywhere we go. And so I just encourage you to look out your windows as you're driving around, but be sure and see the architecture. Thank you very much.